Alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in thumma ma ba'd. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I'm really excited to have this opportunity to share with you a series in which we try and get to know a surah of the Quran, and what better place to begin than Surah Al Fatihah. It's one of the most talked about, or probably the most talked about surah in the entire Quran. When you try to study a tafsir, an explanation of the surah, you get the most voluminous explanations that are ever found in any of our tafsir. So it's very difficult to sum it up in a concise way, but I'm going to try, inshallah. And let's begin with the best place. Really, sometimes, you know, in this series, you'll learn that sometimes there are surahs in which the Prophet ﷺ himself commented about a surah. So that's, in my opinion, the best place to start. This surah is unique because not only does the Prophet himself comment about it, it's actually Allah himself who comments about it too. There's no other surah in the Quran that Allah comments about it, that Allah tells us something special about a surah, and that's something really truly unique to the Fatiha. So let's begin with this incredible narration. This happens in the Prophet's life after he'd migrated from Mecca. He's in Medina now, and that'll be clear from the text itself. An Abi Sa'id ibn al-Mu'alla, this is a companion of the Prophet, he recalls a story that happened with him. He says, كنت أصلي في المسجد فدعاني رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فلم أجبه. I was praying in the mosque, and the Prophet ﷺ called me, and I didn't respond to him. فَقُلْتُ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ إِنِّي كُنْتُ أُصَلِّي. So I told the Messenger ﷺ, because he came late, he said, I was in the middle of prayer, that's why I didn't respond. فَقَالْ أَلَمْ يَقُلِ اللَّهِ. And so he said, didn't Allah say, إِسْتَجِيبُ لِلَّهِ وَلِلْرَّسُولِ إِذَا دَعَاكُمْ لِمَا يُحْيِيكُمْ. Respond to Allah and the Messenger when they call you, or when he calls you to that which will give you life. This is an ayah from Surah Al-Anfal, which is a Madani surah. So this becomes clear that this incident happened after the Prophet is migrated. Of course, the fact that he's praying in the masjid so calmly and the Prophet is calling him is the masjid al-Nabawi. So he says, the Prophet ﷺ called me and he said, لَأُعَلِّمَنَّكَ سُورَةً هِيَ أَعْظَمُ السُّورَ فِي الْقُرْآنِ قَبْلَ أَن تَخْرُجَ مِنَ الْمَسْجِدِ. I'm going to teach you a surah that is the greatest surah of the entire Quran before you leave the masjid. ثُمَّ أَخَذَ بِيَدِي. So then he grabbed my hand. So he kind of reinforced that he's going to teach me this thing. That's what the Prophet did to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَلَمَّا أَرَادَ أَن يَخْرُجَ. This suggests when he finally decided to leave, the Prophet decided to leave the mosque. In other words, he said, before you leave the mosque, I'll tell you something. But then he got busy. The Prophet is teaching others, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's doing other things. And eventually, you know, some time goes by and the Prophet is about to leave. And he noticed that he didn't tell him about this greatest surah of the Quran. قُلْتُ لَهُ أَلَمْ تَقُلْ لَأُعَلِّمَنَّكَ سُورَةً هِيَ أَعْظَمُ سُورَةٍ فِي الْقُرْآنِ. Didn't you say, Messenger of Allah, that you're going to teach me a surah that's the greatest surah of the entire Quran? So he held on, like he had other things to do, but he stayed in the masjid because he's waiting for the Prophet to tell him about the greatest surah. So the Prophet said, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. He recited the Fatiha. He didn't just recite the Fatiha, he said some more things, but I want to pause here and help us appreciate something. This is Medina. Fatiha, the first surah of the Quran, is like the first complete surah revealed. It's one of the earliest revelations of the entire Quran. This is now well over a decade later. Everybody knows about the Fatiha and everybody knows about its merits. So why is this a big, why is he saying, first of all, holding this young man back and telling him, don't leave, I'm going to tell you the best surah of the whole Quran. And this young man's like, oh, this is going to be epic. It's going to be something amazing. And then he holds him back and then tells him Fatiha, as if this young man doesn't know the Fatiha. He does. The reason this is important to note is because through this, the Prophet has taught us something, that an appreciation of the Fatiha is something that has to be refreshed and renewed. You can't assume that you've internalized the value of the Fatiha and move on. And that's what I'm going to try to explain to you today in through the words of the Prophet himself and the words of the Quran. Like I said, no other surah has been described in the way the Fatiha has been described in the Quran. And it's absolutely mind-blowing. When I was studying this, I realized I didn't appreciate the Fatiha for what it is, you know? And may Allah Azza wa Jal continue to give all of us an increased appreciation for His word. So he says, the Prophet goes on to say, "He is sab'ul mathani wal Qur'anul azim alladhi utituhu." It is the seven al-mathani, the seven, and then the Arabic word al-mathani. Now al-mathani means a couple of things. The common translation is the seven highly praised ones. The seven ones full of a lot of praise. Seven referring to the seven ayat of the Fatiha. So he says, this is the greatest surah of the Quran. It's the seven highly praised verses, or the verses that contain the most praise, or they are worthy of the most praise themselves. And then he says, وَالْقُرْآنُ الْعَظِيمُ. And it is the great recital. It's the great Quran itself. It is as though the essence of the entire Quran is the Fatiha, according to the Prophet himself. وَالْقُرْآنُ الْعَظِيمُ. الَّذِي أُتِيتُهُ. That I have been given. Al-Quran is not just the name of the book. The Quran, the word Quran also means recital, meaning the great recital that I have been granted, the greatest thing that I can recite is the Fatiha. That's what the Prophet is saying, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in this incredible hadith. Another similar hadith, he's talking to Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and he says, Ummul Qur'an, hiya sab'ul mathani wal Qur'anul azim. The mother and the essence of the entire Qur'an is the seven highly praised ones. I gave you one of the meanings, I held off on the other meaning of mathani, I'll come to it in a second. And the great Qur'an, meaning the Fatiha itself is actually called the great Qur'an. It's one of its names, you know, the great, the grand recital, subhanallah. Now, what is this sab' mathani, the seven highly praised or seven something else that it means? Where does it come from? It's actually a revelation that Allah gave. It's part of Surah Al Hijr. It's the 15th surah of the Quran that describes the Quran itself. And Allah says, وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَاكَ سَبْعًا مِنَ الْمَثَانِي وَالْقُرْآنَ الْعَظِيمِ. We have given you seven from out of the very highly praised ones and the great Quran. This ambiguous statement, we've given you seven highly praised ones, was made in Makki Quran, and the Prophet years later, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, according to this narration, is explaining to this young man, you know what Allah meant by the seven highly praised ones? He meant Fatiha. He meant this surah. But you know what really blew my mind is why use the word mathani? Like, there's so many Arabic words for praise, but this word is different. It's very unique. And the verb that comes from it, athna, or yuthnuna sudurahum, is used in the Quran. Athna comes from the Arabic word ithnain. The most common word from it is ithnain, which means two. And thana is to actually fold something into two, like thana al-ard, for example, in the Arabic language, is to take the earth and, you know, fold it over so that you can plant seeds in it. So when you double up your digging, that's actually called the act of thani. Similarly, when you fold a piece of paper in two, they say thani al-kitab, the fold of the book that's been folded into two. So the word thana actually has to do with pairing. Now, this is profound, because now the Quran is seven from those that are incredibly paired, that are paired together. And that's what we're going to dig into a little bit, inshallah. What in the world does that mean, that they're paired together? I want you to hold on to that thought as I read some of the other narrations. But I will tell you one thing about it. You know, the Fatiha, every time we recite in prayer, we pair it with some other part of the Quran. Right? It's the greatest part of the Quran that is always paired with something else. Like, I can stand in prayer, and I can't just start with Baqarah. I can't just start with Ali Imran. It's possible to just recite the Fatiha and nothing else. But it's never possible to recite anything else without the Fatiha. It's always paired with something else. And you know why that's important? Because you know how when you're giving a speech or you're giving a talk or something, there's an introduction and then you get into your subject? It's as though Allah wants us to think, no matter what part of the Quran you read, the introduction to it is the Fatiha. Like, if you're reciting Surah An-Nas, the introduction to Surah An-Nas is Fatiha. Recite Fatiha first, then read Nas. It should frame the way you think about any surah of the Quran. Don't lose sight of the Fatiha. The Fatiha is like the lens that you put on, and then you see the rest of the Quran through that lens. So when you say Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, praise and gratitude, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, the overwhelming loving care and mercy of Allah, these Maliki Yawmiddin, the Allah's ownership of Judgment Day, you know, our commitment to Him, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, our desperation to be guided. These sentiments should override everything you read, and you should read it in its color. You know, when somebody is angry and they read anger into what they're reading. When someone's, you know, afraid and they read fear into what they're reading. We're supposed to read Fatiha into what we're reading in the Quran. It's actually, without which, it's like you're missing one of the two. This is one of the meanings of Mathani, but I'll keep moving along. عن أبي سعيد الخدري رضي الله تعالى عنه قال كنا في مسير لنا فنزلنا فجاءت جارية فقال إن سيد الحي سليم. So we were traveling, we were in some way walking around, and a girl came and said that the head of the household is okay. وإن نفرنا غيب. Something's wrong with our the head of the household, and the people are all gone. He's been poisoned, and we don't know what to do. We don't know how to heal him. فَهَلْ مِنْكُمْ رَاقٍ. Is there anyone who, a healer among you? And healing back in the day was like, you know, medicine, or they believed in chanting and things like that. But then there's ruqya from the Prophet's tradition, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You can recite Quran on someone for healing purposes too. فَقَامَ مَعَهَا رَجُلٌ مَا كُنَّا نَائِبُهُ بِرُقْيَةٍ فَرَقَى فَبَرَأَ مِنْهُ فَأَمَرَ لَهُ بِثَلَاثِينَ شَاةً وَسَقَى لَبَنًا. So what happens is this guy comes around that nobody knows, and he says, I think I can help. And he goes in there and he heals the guy. We don't know what he did, but he recites something and he heals the guy. And they were so happy, they gave him 30 sheep, and they gave him milk, and he got all these gifts from them because he healed the head of the household who's been poisoned. فَلَمَّا رَجَعَ قُلْنَا لَهُ So when the guy came back, that nobody knew, what is this guy, what did he do to heal this poisoned man? We asked him, أَكُنْتَ تُحْسِنُ رُقْيَةً Are you good at healing? Is that, you know, are you experienced in this kind of thing? أو كنت تلقي؟ قال لا ما رقيت إلا بأم الكتاب. Actually, no, I never healed anyone except I recite Fatiha. I recite the mother of the book. I just recite the Fatiha and healing happens. قلنا لا تحدث شيئا تحدث شيئا حتى نأتي أو نسأل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. He says, okay, enough. We're not going to take this from you until we ask the Prophet himself. Until we ask the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم himself. فلما قدمنا المدينة, so we went back to Medina. ذكرناه للنبي. We told the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم what had happened. ما كان يدريه أنها رقية. And he says, who told him that that's ruqya, that that's healing? Meaning, wow, he knew that that's healing. The Prophet ﷺ actually acknowledged that reciting the Fatiha for someone can be a source of healing for them. اقسموا وضربوا لي بسهم. And he said, the gift that you were given, you should distribute it among yourselves. You shouldn't hold on to those gifts. Spread those around. Subhanallah. You know? So he actually acknowledged the fact that the Fatiha has the merits of even serving as healing, as cure. عن ابن عباس رضي الله تعالى عنهما the third narration بينما جبريل قاعد عند النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم سمعنا نقيضا من فوقه فرفع رأسه So we are sitting and Jibreel, the Prophet tells us that Jibreel is sitting by the company of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم himself and he hears a loud sound from above so he raised his head هذا باب من السماء فتح اليوم لم يفتح قط إلا اليوم He said there's a door in the sky This is a door in the sky that has been opened today that has never been opened before فنزل منه ملك and an angel came down from that door فقال هذا ملك نزل إلى الأرض لم ينزل قط إلا اليوم and an angel has come down today that has never come down to the earth before this day فسلم وقال and that angel came for just one purpose he said salam to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and he said أبشر بنورين أتيتهما لم يؤتهما نبي قبلك you should feel congratulated because of two sources of light or two lights Two glorious lights that you have been given, that no prophet before you has been given. فاتحة الكتاب وخواتيم سورة البقرة. The opening of the book, meaning Surah Al-Fatiha, and the ending verses of Surah Al-Baqarah. لن تقرأ بحرف منها إلا أعطيته. Subhanallah. What a promise that came from the sky just to talk about Fatiha and the end of Baqarah. He says, nobody recites even a single letter from it, except they're given what they ask. Meaning what they're asking, what are we asking in the Fatiha? اهدنا الصراط المستقيم. We're sincerely asking Allah for guidance. When you with your heart recite the Fatiha, it is not turned away. That is the promise of Allah sent by an angel who's never come down except to give delivery of that promise. Subhanallah. The fourth narration. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه. من صلى صلاة لم يقرأ فيها بأم القرآن فهي خداج ثلاث غير تمام. You know, so he says, you know, whoever prays, And they didn't recite the mother of the book. Again, he doesn't say Fatiha, he says the mother of the book. You know, like a mother is inseparable from the child? This mother is inseparable from the rest of the Quran, like that, you know? And it takes care of the child, like the Fatiha takes care of our perception of the entire Quran. So whoever doesn't recite the mother of the Quran, then the prayer is no good. And, you know, these are incomplete. So he says, فَقِيلَ لِأَبِي هُرَيْرَةَ It was said to Abu Huraira, إِنَّا نَكُونُ وَرَاءَ الْإِمَامِ We pray behind the imam. We don't recite. So he says, اقرأ بها في نفسك. Just recite it in your heart. Just recite the Fatiha in your heart. فإني سمعت رسول صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول قال الله تعالى قسمت الصلاة بيني وبين عبدي نصفين. This is one of the most profound ahadith about the Quran ever. He says, I heard the Prophet himself say that Allah says, now it's Allah commenting about the Fatiha. So Allah has already commented about the Fatiha and the seven highly praised ones and the seven that are always paired. That's coming. But now Allah is commenting again. And this time in the first person, it's called a hadith Qudsi. He says, I divided the prayer between myself and my slave into two halves. وَلِعَبْدِي مَا سَأَلْ And my slave will get whatever he asks. فَإِذَا قَالَ الْعَبْدُ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ When the slave says, all praise and gratitude belongs to Allah, master of all nations and all peoples. That's الْحَمْدُ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ Allah says, حَمِدَنِي عَبْدِي My servant has praised me. And has thanked me. وَإِذَا قَالَ الرَّحْمَنَ الرَّحِيمَ And whenever the servant says, الرَّحْمَنَ الرَّحِيمَ Then Allah says, قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى أَثْنَى عَلَيَّ عَبْدِي My slave has praised me again. But the word is أَثْنَى, which is the same as مَثَانِي. He has associated something with me. The word athna also means praise, just like it means the word to. It actually means to associate something with Allah or associate something with anybody else. Athna alayhi khayran, or athnahu khayran, athnahu sharran in Arabic. You associate good with someone, you've done thana. You associate bad with someone, you've done thana. Allah says, when we say Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, my servant has associated, you know, mercy and love and care with me. And so that's what he's saying when he says, athna alayya abdi. When my servant says, maliki yawmiddin, qala majjadani abdi. He says, when the servant says, master of, you know, and the owner of the day of judgment, that my servant has actually declared my grandeur, my glory, you know, my seniority even. Tamjeed in Arabic is to appreciate the majesty of someone. وَقَالَ مَرَّةً فَوَّضَ إِلَىٰ عَبْدِي. And another time he said, whenever the servant says, you are the master of the day of judgment, it's like he's left all of his affairs in my hands. وَإِذَا قَالَ وَإِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ قَالَ هَذَا بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ عَبْدِي وَلِعَبْدِي مَا سَأَلَ. And when my servant says, you know, we only you we worship, only your, you know, aid do we seek, then this is Allah saying, and then Allah says, this is between me and my servant gets whatever he asked for. فَإِذَا قَالَ اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ. When the servant recites the last part of the Fatiha, the path of those, you know, guide us to the straight path, the path of those you showered favor upon, not the recipients of rage, nor the lost. قَالَ هَذَا لِعَبْدِي. This is for my servant. وَلِعَبْدِي مَا سَأَلَ. My slave gets whatever he asked. Look at this beautiful narration. The Allah himself recites the entire Fatiha and turns the entire Fatiha into a conversation between us and him. Whenever I say Alhamdulillah, I say it here on the earth, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Allah himself responds. He takes the time to respond to me. Whenever I say Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawmiddin, Iyaka Na'budu Wa Iyaka Nasta'in, he doesn't wait for me to finish reciting the whole surah and then respond. He responds to every ayah that I recite. Every single time, إِذَا قَالَ, every time he recites, every time he says these words, it's mind-blowing that actually Fatiha isn't just something Allah comments about. Allah is saying for every single ayah of the Fatiha. This is why they're the highly praised ones. They are so highly praised that Allah praises the one who recites them. He acknowledges the one who recites them. He associates himself with the one who recites them. That's part of the meaning of Mathani. What more grand recital can there be that you've actually engaged in direct conversation with Allah without realizing? Incredible. Now, if you look at this narration also, it's broken up into three parts. In the beginning parts, this is for me. My slave has praised me. He's associated mercy with me. He's declared my majesty. It was all about what we have done for Allah. The middle ayah, we worship you, we seek your help. What did Allah say? This is between me and my slave. And the last part, guide us, keep us on the straight path, guide, you know, show us the path of those who showered favor upon, keep us away from the path of those who, you know, earned your rage or earned rage, and those that are lost. Allah says, this is for my slave. So it began with what's for God, what's for Allah. The middle was what's for us and for Allah. And the last part was what's for ourselves. It's completely balanced, subhanAllah. And that's the pairing that the word Mathani means. We're learning something, a really beautiful secret about the Quran itself in the word Mathani, which is a description of the Fatiha, Sab'an min al-Mathani, that everything in the Quran is paired. Everything in the Quran, Allah will teach you one thing and pair it with another. He'll talk about day, he'll pair it with night. He'll talk about hell, he'll pair it with heaven. He'll talk about good people, he'll pair it with bad people. You know, he'll pair things. And sometimes those pairs are obvious and sometimes they're not obvious, but much of what the Quran is actually pairing things together. Now, what I want to do before I let you guys go is show you some things about this Mathani in the Fatiha. You know, of course, this pairing, because Allah doesn't just say these are the only seven verses or seven ayat that have pairs in them, that things are balanced in or two things are put together. But this is the greatest of them. This is the greatest of them. So I'll share some observations about the Fatiha with you and we'll conclude, inshallah. Some things that are just truly unique about the Fatiha. The first thing is that if you notice, praise and gratitude belongs to Allah. The first ayah, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawmiddin. These are actually conclusions about God, who God is. It's kind of knowledge of who Allah is, right? That's the first three verses are just, you can call them knowledge. And then you declare, Iyaka Na'budu Wa Iyaka Nasta'een. It leads to action. I'm ready to worship you and I'm seeking your help. Now you've taken action. So you've got the knowledge of God paired with you taking action. There's a pair between knowledge and action. Now, if you look at the last half of the Fatiha, guide us to the straight path. What is the straight path? The path of those you showered favor upon. If you think about these people, we want to go down the path of successful people that came before us. These are people that had the right kind of knowledge and acted on it. They had the right merger between knowledge and action. And if you go further, not those who earned rage. Who earns rage? People who know, they know the right thing and they don't do it anyway. They are worthy that you should be angry at them. That's the people of rage. So they have knowledge, but they don't act. And the lost are people who, even if they want to act, they can't because they don't have knowledge, even if they want to act. So if you go back, every knowledge and action are paired. It starts with knowledge. It goes to the people who have, and we take action. We say we're ready to take action. Then Allah says, He describes the people who had both knowledge and action. Then He describes people that have knowledge but no action. Then He describes people that have action but no knowledge. And that's the perfect pair, subhanAllah. Another interesting, beautiful, you know, pairing that I want to share with you about Fatiha, there's so many of them, but just a couple more, is Insha and Khabar. I love this. The word Insha in Arabic means when you say something out of emotion. And the word Khabar means when you inform someone of something. This surah, this statement, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, all the way to the end, is incredible information. Like, you could teach this stuff, right? I could teach it for hours and hours and hours. What's embedded inside this text? That would be Khabar. It's informational. But sometimes, like, you know, you're late for work and you're stuck in traffic and somehow you wiggle through traffic, found the parking spot, got into the office and you're not late. You look at your watch and you say, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. At that point, you were not giving information. You were declaring your emotions. Fatiha is a perfect blend between what you say as information. You're making statements of fact, but you're also declaring your own emotions. Yes, praise and gratitude does in fact belong to the master of all the worlds. He is in fact Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. He is in fact Maliki Yawmiddin. These are all facts. But at the same time, you can say this as though your heart is crying these words. It's a statement of emotion. So it pairs, this surah incredibly pairs emotion and it pairs knowledge. You know, what happens in the heart and what happens in the mind. This surah, subhanAllah, you know, the last pair I'll share with you in this introduction is the pair between mercy and justice. You know, on the one hand, there are people who expect Allah Azza wa Jal to be merciful. And that's covered in Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. But on the other hand, there are people who think Allah will only be just. Like, He'll just punish. You know, and if Allah is just, then nobody survives this punishment. Because none of us have done enough good deeds to cover for the bad deeds that we've done. He overcompensates our good deeds. We all know that. For every letter, we get 10 good deeds. You know, for making a simple dua, we can get 100,000 good deeds. There are good deeds just being thrown our way for really what seems like no rhyme or reason. We're just being given good deeds, good deeds, good deeds. And when we do something bad, we're only punished for, it counts for one, you know. And even then, if you make istighfar, it gets erased. So really, it's tipped in the scale of mercy. But if you think too much about the mercy of Allah and how He wants you to earn good deeds, then you might start getting complacent and think, yeah, He's going to forgive anyway. It's okay. No big deal. And you start taking His authority in a lackadaisical kind of way. You don't really concern yourself with, yeah, I mean, I do some haram things, but, you know, it's not that bad. I mean, after all, He is Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. So you could try to take advantage of it. It's balanced out again. That's why Maliki Yawmiddin is important. Some people are so scared of Allah. They're like, Allah is going to punish me. He's going to burn me. He's going to throw me into hell. He's going to question me about everything I did. And that fear overwhelms them. And their picture of God becomes a very scary one. What does the Fatiha do? On the one hand, rely on Allah's love and mercy. Rely on Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. And on the other hand, don't forget that you can't take advantage of His love and mercy. Maliki Yawmiddin balances both of those things. It even balances my relationship with Him. I declared that I'm going to worship Him. I declared it. إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ. But at the same time, that's what I want to do for Him. But what's He going to do for me? إِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. We seek His help. Right? So first you give what Allah wants, and then you're going to get what you want. You know, that's the balance between what you want to give Allah, what's due to Him, and what you'd like to get for yourself. On every level, this surah is balanced and paired on top of paired. And that's why it's a sab' al-mathani wal-Qur'an al-azim. May Allah Azza wa Jal give us an appreciation of this incredible, incredible surah and help us, you know, really acknowledge the wonder of the surah every time we recite it. Barakallahu li wa lakum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.